Okay. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. And a very warm welcome. Whatever time zone you are in, you are welcome to the CIONET International web conference. The topic of today is key learnings from Silicon Valley CIOs. And we have invited two top CIOs from the Valley to join us today so that they can share what they have learned working for tech companies in the Valley. Both of them, Mark Settle and Kirsten Wolberg, have been working in large corporates as CIOs and in high tech companies. And so they have a very good view on what makes it special to work in a Silicon Valley company. And so they are going to spend the next hour with us sharing their experiences and learnings. So if you are following this conference in Zoom, because we're broadcasting also in LinkedIn and on YouTube and on Twitter and on Facebook, but if you're a CIONET member and you're joining us on Zoom, then please use the chat. So there's a chat function in Zoom, and make sure that you chat to all the participants and not just to the panelists, which is the default. So chat with all the panelists for all the questions that you have. And we're also going to launch a number of specific chat discussion points. And so this conference is going to be recorded as well and going to be made available later. I'm also going to take the opportunity to say that we are very, very proud to announce that we have just launched CIONET in the US. So under the leadership of Mark Zawacki, who joins us from San Francisco today as well, we are now launching CIONET in Atlanta with Lisa West, in Miami with Jesse England, and in Philadelphia with Amy McElvey. So if you're in these regions, you are very, very welcome to, of course, join our community if you are a digital leader. So we're very, very excited to be launching CIONET in the US. So let's go back to the program of today. And I'm going to ask Mark Settle, Kirsten Wolberg, and Mark Zawacki to come online. I'm going to stop the share here, get out of my, and there we go, out of my PowerPoint, and here we are. So a very warm welcome. Kirsten, how are you today? Make sure that you're unmuted so you're still on.
I was going to say, yes, I'm well, but I find myself on mute. So I'm well today. How are you?
Good, good, good. Very warm welcome. Mark as well.
Mark. Mark. Happy to join you.
And a very warm welcome, Mark Zawacki. And you're on mute still as well, Mark. So.
Good afternoon, everyone in Europe. Good morning in the US, and good evening. I think we have some people in Asia and Australia joining us today.
Yes. So we're going to spend the next hour together with the four of us discussing the key learnings for CIOs from Silicon Valley CIOs. So let me start with a bit the official introduction of our two guests here today. So Kirsten Wolberg is originally from Alaska. And then she went to sunny California, studied there, and then later on she also studied at Kellogg and at Stanford. She started her career in banking and in consulting, and then her career took her into tech. She was VP Technology at Charles Schwab. She was CIO at Salesforce.com, VP Technology at PayPal, and now for almost 3 years, she is at DocuSign, where she is the Chief Technology and Operations Officer. So a very warm welcome again, Kirsten. I will give you the opportunity in a moment to introduce yourself. The second guest that we have with us today is Mark Settle. And Mark originally studied geology. So he has studied geology at MIT, even has a PhD in geology from Brown University, and he's held 7 positions as CIO, both in corporates, as in tech companies and corporates such as Oxy, Visa, Arrow Electronics, Staples, and in tech companies such as BMC, IHS, and Okta. And Mark has written several books, and his latest book that we can warmly recommend is called Truth from the Valley, a practical primer on IT management for the next decade. So also a very warm welcome again to you, Mark. And so our main moderator of today is of course, Mark Zawacki. And Mark, he lives in beautiful San Francisco, where he now leads CIONET in the US. And for the last 20 years, Mark has been working with large global organizations where he focused on strategy, growth, innovation, and organizational change. And with all these introductions behind us, Mark Zawacki, I'm going to hand it over to you. So take us away and let's discuss what we can learn from Silicon Valley CIOs.
Thanks, Hendrik. And again, thank you, everyone, for joining us this afternoon and this morning. As many of you know on the webinar today, I've known Hendrik for about, 20 years, but this is really going to be a fun day because with Kirsten and Mark, one of them was a colleague 20 years ago and the other was a client about 20 years ago. And you have to figure out which is which. So if you can solve that riddle throughout the day, you're doing well. So it's really fun to have a former client and a former colleague both together in the same webinar. Fantastic. Let me let both Kirsten and Mark elaborate a little bit. I know Mark gave the intro, Hendrik gave the intros, but Kirsten, starting with you, if you just want to build out an introduction a bit more, and then follow it on with what are your perspectives right now with Silicon Valley and, you know, its importance and how you see it, say, evolving. But just start with, you know, building out that introduction if you can.
Yeah, so my role at DocuSign, I started, as Hendrik said, almost 3 years ago. So it's been an interesting journey. I started right before the IPO, which was in August of 2018, and have seen the company grow tremendously from being a single product e-signature company to now a full platform company that runs the gamut across the preparing agreements, signing agreements, acting on those agreements, and then analyzing and managing the agreements. So we've got products in all four product lines. And with the growth of the company has been a growth of the role. So it's not, I don't have just a standard enterprise CIO role. It also expands into physical and cybersecurity, into the full data space, a lot of operations functions, as well as the risk and compliance functions. So it's been a very wild ride, particularly recently. So I'm very honored and excited to be here. So thank you for including me. And, you know, as I look at the Silicon Valley right now, certainly everybody has for the last 4 months, I wouldn't say pivoted, but I'm going to say we've needed to retrench. We've needed to retrench to figure out how to operate in this fully remote environment. And I think that in this pause, we've stalled a bit, probably from an innovation perspective. And as I look forward, it's back re-engaging that innovation engine and now understanding how we collaborate differently in this remote world, understanding what the new forces are within the marketplace. I see us coming back as strong as ever in this space to solve for the problems of our time. And I think that's one of the things that Silicon Valley has been known for, for decades, is just the ability to understand and see what the problems are and quickly innovate to find solutions to solve them.
That's great, Kirsten. And Mark?
Just for the last year, I've been doing a lot of advisory work with smaller companies. And just to start off with some controversy, I'm going to slightly disagree with Kirsten in that, I think to some degree, especially the smaller firms, I mean, the ones that are like 20 people or 50 people or 150, the pressure to go sell is not as great because of the crisis. I mean, there's an understanding out there that this is a tough time to start to develop a market for a new concept. And so a lot of these smaller, very embryonic kind of firms, they're doubling down on their R&D efforts. And, it's the energy level and the enthusiasm and the dedication, and it's just it's enervating. I really enjoy working with a lot of these firms because they've got their vision of where they want to, be and a year, 2 years, or 5 years. And again, many of the folks that are not at the size of Salesforce or Google or Facebook. I mean, I think, you know, in this kind of a market, that there are all kinds of issues about product direction and sales opportunities and adjacent markets and things of that nature. But the, you know, the core lifeblood of Silicon Valley is alive and well. That's all I can tell your audience.
Mm. And Mark, I'm reminded, I just saw yesterday, the day before, you were formerly CIO at Okta. One of the co-founders, I was on record earlier this week saying they grew from, in 12 years, they formed in the during the GFC of 08, and it's a 25 billion market cap company in 12 short years. So I think that reinforces your idea that these early stage companies in a downturn are pedaling pretty hard.
Yep, absolutely.
Hey, let's switch gears to talent. And obviously, as Kirsten points out, it's been a crazy 4 months. But, you know, rewind the tape a few years and just look at let's discuss the talent issues, right? It's a very competitive environment here. Your people can walk across the street and leave for maybe higher equity and better terms. I know both of you have been fighting that throughout your careers. So, Kirsten, if you could just comment on, you know, how you think about talent, how you think about retention strategies, because it's a very, very different environment, I think, than perhaps other traditional CIOs face.
Yeah, so we've stayed constant in our recruiting efforts through the pandemic. We moved to completely remote, and we actually moved to remote before the shelter in place orders across the globe. And we have continued to find a very solid pipeline of good talent. I do think that, you know, as Mark said, some of the smaller companies, while they may be focused on R&D, the lack of sales and the lack of cash inflow in some cases is bringing additional talent to market, or it's bringing talent to market that may still have a job, but they are looking at other companies that might give them a bit more security. And so whereas they might not have been willing to talk to another company previously, suddenly their ears have perked up a bit. So we are finding great talent that's still out there, and we are recruiting heavily. You know, one of the things I think about the most, Mark, and from the retention standpoint is culture. Because I think, you know, a lot of employees stay with a company because of the culture. They like how the company feels to be in that company. And when we're all working from our living rooms, our bedrooms, you know, our sheds in the backyard, depending on what it might be, it's harder to sustain that culture. I think with the nucleus of employees that were at the company prior to the pandemic, it's a lot easier, but bringing on new employees and how do you infuse that culture? So I can't say that I have a lot of the answers there, but we have far more consistent touch points through Zoom. We have a lot more communication than we have in the past. We're doing, you know, longer durations with buddies as new employees are coming on board, and, you know, always open. So anybody who's on the call, if you've got great ideas of how you're maintaining your culture through the pandemic, I would love to hear about them as well.
I'm going to interrupt here quickly. We run a poll on the war on IT talent. For those of you who are not on Zoom, can't follow that, so I'm going to explain the results here. So we asked the question, is the war on IT talent coming to an end in your market? I mean, we're a bit in a crisis, an historical economic crisis potentially. So is the war on IT talent coming to an end? And so there were three options. Option one was there's now enough talent available to recruit, and about 9% selected that. The second option was good talent can be found, but it is hard. That's 50% of the responses, and 41% said, no, the war for talent is still raging. So over back to you, Mark.
Fantastic, thank you. You know, I want to elaborate, Mark, I'll come back to you, but Kirsten, let's elaborate on that. It was very high profile when Twitter said, hey, we're just going to close our headquarter office. Everyone's going to work remote. I think the press globally is kind of picking up on this as a trend. And in preparation for today's webinar, you took the opposite view and you said, look, culture is important. Working from our shed is probably not sustainable. We're going to have a presence, a sizable presence, and we're not going to deviate from that much going forward. That still remains very important. So maybe you could amplify that, because I don't think this is a one size fits all. Everyone's going to run for the hills.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think every company is going to look at it differently. I think just human beings, we crave connection, and connection is certainly easier when it's in person and you're in proximity. All of our teams from a development perspective work in Agile. You know, one of the core tenets of Agile is this co-location and being able to like lean over and talk to that person. While yes, Zoom and other technologies like Slack and the Atlassian suite have given us the ability to do those kinds of collaborations virtually, people still want to do them in person. And we recognize that. Our employees are telling us, you know, they don't want to come back into the office while it's unsafe and while public transportation feels very daunting. They do want to come back into the office. So it's not a, I don't ever want to come back. I love this new normal. Do I think that we're probably going to increase our percentage of fully remote employees? Yes. Prior to the pandemic, DocuSign was about 20% of our employees were fully remote. Do I think that number will go to 30 or 40%? I do, because, you know, I do think that there are some employees that for whom the commute is just untenable, and they have found that this new normal working from home is a better solution for them. But I do believe for the majority of DocuSign employees, we, myself included, we want to get back into the office. We want to, you know, begin collaborating. And I think if you look at, you know, your first question, Mark, I talked about innovation in the Valley. That's one of the things that's harder in this fully remote environment. There is nothing that replaces a bunch of really smart people getting into a room together and just solving problems together. And there is fatigue. I mean, it's energizing when you get in that room and you do that. When you do it over Zoom, it comes with fatigue. It comes with mental fatigue. It comes with physical fatigue. And you just don't have that same energy level. And while we are going to persevere through it and we are going to continue to innovate, I still think there is a very real place for face-to-face, in-office collaboration that's not going away.
It feels like, to summarize, it feels like the real trade-off in this whole discussion or argument of remote working is the flexibility, but on the other end of that continuum is the culture and the way of working, and there's no right answer, and who will win? And Mark, what are your thoughts on the talent issues and even wrapping around this remote issue? But how are you sizing up, you know, what happened prior to February? And I know some of this you even covered in your book.
Yeah, so I think I'm going to underscore something Kirsten said. I don't know if the listeners all picked up on this, but so she's basically encouraging you to poach on your, you know, on other companies. I mean, this is a time of instability, and there may be people who were, you know, perfectly happy with the status quo and had long careers, and you would think, well, that person would never be interested in joining us. Just maybe you might just kind of like check that out. You might just want to do a little outreach, you know, a little relationship cultivation. So that could be a tremendous opportunity. And the other thing I wanted to do, I wanted to try to put a little Silicon Valley edge on this culture conversation, because every company has a culture, and you know, it's more or less attractive to individuals. And you can't, there's no formula for the culture that's kind of universally attractive to everybody. But when I think of what's unique in Silicon Valley, there's a couple of threads that are recurrent, or you see over and over again. So one is innovation, like we've talked about before, the thrill of doing something for the first time. I mean, that is it's an elixir for a lot of people. You know, the second one is like the size of these companies and the intimacy that you can have with the leaders. Like you can see the founder of the company in the restroom, you know, you'll run into them at lunch. There'll be all hands meetings. And so, you know, it's another comment that that Kirsten made before, which is suddenly those big bad companies like DocuSign, Kirsten, don't look so, you know, so foreign and bureaucratic as they did before, you know. So now maybe they're a little bit more appealing. You know, and just to be comical, I mean, some people love the free lunches. Like, they just like, hey, you know, I just got out of school. I get a free lunch every day. I play ping pong in the afternoon at 3:00. And then a bunch of us go to a, you know, this is all things we used to do. I mean, that's the culture that I've had at college. And this is the one that I still enjoy. So there's no prescriptive formula, but culture is a bit of a trump card. The last observation or point I wanted to come back to, Mark, you specifically started this conversation about retention strategies. And one of the things that doesn't get talked about a lot in the Valley is that as you start to have this explosive growth, there aren't really linear career paths in many parts of a fast growing company. And what I mean by that is you start bringing in people from the outside that have experience doing things in sales and marketing and engineering from much bigger companies, because you aspire to be a Salesforce, you aspire to be a DocuSign. And so you want to go find those people that, you know, can look around a corner and kind of see what's coming next when we go from 1,000 people to 1,500 people to 2,000 people. And as you bring in that talent at the middle management level or the middle technical level, you've got to really find your millennial hypos, the younger people that have been with you from the start, that have career runway that you can develop, that can take on broader responsibilities. And that won't be everybody. But if you're not careful and you don't provide that care and feeding for those high potential people, you know, there's a whole stratum of people in the company that start to think, you know, what's my career progression path here? You know, where does this go to? Because I keep seeing them hiring people from all the big name companies in the Valley to come in here and kind of run this place going forward. So, I mean, this is true in any company as far as cultivating your high potential staff members. But here, if you don't put a little extra effort into it, just the point, Mark, you made earlier, there's lots of opportunities.
Yeah, and let's touch on that, Mark. This place we call home, you and I and Kirsten call home, hundreds of companies have been built from zero to, you know, tens of billions of dollars in a decade, right? You just look back and the Googles, the Facebooks, the Apples, the DocuSigns, I'm in the shadow of Salesforce Tower this morning, but these companies have all been built in a short period of time, and you're saying when it's nonlinear, you can't do any career planning. But I think there's a deeper point in there that it attracts a certain employee that signs up for the unknown, that wants to work, you know, wants to work on a very big problem and has some ambition. It's not a, you know, it's not necessarily about the equity. It's not necessarily about the function or role they're in, but they're signing up for a kind of a big unknown, and they kind of trust the investors and they trust the leadership and they trust that environment that there's an opportunity to do that. And that's an intangible that's very, very hard to measure, but we see it every day. How do you keep people motivated in that environment when it doesn't always go as planned, right? What are the downsides of that?
You mean when you don't have the traction in the marketplace, the product or service isn't taking off?
Partly you don't have the traction in the marketplace, or partly, you know, partly there's some big adjustments and big turns that are made. The companies they're not doing what they set out they would originally do.
I'm not sure I fully understand the question, but I think at a personal level, you know, when you join in a smaller company, there's not as much role specialization. And so if you're in marketing, you know, you plan the annual meeting, you know, you do social media broadcasting, you do field events, and you're kind of like, you know, you're a Swiss Army knife. They can use you in 12 different ways. And, you know, if I'm 5 years out of school, I think this is great. I'm learning new things. I'm doing new things, et cetera. And Kirsten has a extensive Salesforce background. You know, that doesn't happen in a big company. Like, you know, if you're in social media marketing, maybe all you get to work on is Twitter and Facebook. You know, like there's five people that are doing that. And so you have your little piece of the pie. So I think that can also be, I don't want to say a deterrent or discouraging, but I think people then have to make a career choice as to, is there a specialization that I can focus on in this company and develop into a real long-term, you know, profession? Or some people bail out. I mean, some people bail out at like 1,500 or 2,000 people, and the fun and the thrill and the adrenaline rush of a smaller company, they go find something else to, you know, that's 400 people to start all over again.
Yeah, there's some questions coming in as well from the chat, sorry, Kirsten. Maybe Luke, if you could summarize some of the questions and then Kirsten can maybe go into that.
So one of the main topics that's being debated in the chat is the relationship between company culture on the one hand side and work from home, remote working. Can you maintain, can you build a company culture through screens and webcams? So what's your reaction to that?
So I think we've proven that companies can sustain in a remote environment. What I don't personally believe is that building a unique culture through a remote environment, I don't yet know how to do that. Someone may, but I just don't see it. I know there are a number of companies out there that have from the get-go have been fully remote companies, but I would challenge to ask what exactly defines the culture of those companies other than the tenets of remote working. And so when I look at DocuSign, our tenets of our culture are being more agreeable, being loved, and being more responsible in the communities and in our workplace. And so those are tenets that support being on site. And it is far, I'll say certainly easier to do those things in proximity than it is to do it remotely. I mean, I'm doing crazy fun stuff to try to keep the culture up. I do dance parties with my team. We do 10-minute dance parties 3 times a week, you know, just to keep people connected. And ask me anything sessions. I do those 2 to 3 times a week as well to keep the communication going and to try to ensure that, you know, the heart, one of our values is loved, you know, the heart of this company has to continue in a remote space. And yes, you can love remotely, but it's certainly a lot easier to love closer in proximity.
Okay, Mark?
Maybe that's the take home soundbite from this whole thing. You can love remotely. I have to think about that. You know, I think one of we'll get ourselves into here is talking about like all at home or all in the office. Yeah. And yeah. I'm sure that the remote percentage will go up. You know, the permanently remote percentage will likely go up to some degree. But I just think you're going to see a whole lot more hybrid, you know, styles where my team, we say, hey, let's go in on like Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. You know, let's plan activities and then work from home and get like the stuff that we can do more efficiently from home. And more accommodation of people's personal schedules. And you know, the downside of that, is people start working a lot more than 40 hours or 50 hours. I mean, pretty soon people are doing things on weekends. And you know, when you start to take the structure of the workplace away to a degree, like it sort of never stops. And I'm not just speculating about that. I've talked to many people that said, you know, I liked getting in the car and commuting because that was like my mental break. Like I stopped, I went home. That's when I spent time with my kids. That's when I relaxed. You know, that's when I engaged in a sports activity or whatever. And now it's so strange because like it's nothing works all the time. And, you know, I don't really get away from it the way I used to. So that, I mean, I just think these polar opposites, you got to be careful. And I think maybe Hendrik, you brought this up. You know, it's only week 15 here. You know, like we're talking about like seismic, cataclysmic inflection changes in the way the world is going to operate. I'd just give it a little more runtime before we make some kind of final prediction.
Your remark on structure and the fact that people then start working at any possible time and point in their week and day and so on is quite contradictory to one of the remarks and the questions coming in the chat, where people are wondering also whether the increased home working would leave room for more flexibility also on the schedule, whether part-time jobs and part-time interactions would be easier remotely than in the classical in-the-office type context.
Okay. I think, Hendrik, you may want to share the poll result of our second poll. I think it's fascinating. The central question is, does Silicon Valley, and then I'm going to ask Mark and Kirsten to comment, does Silicon Valley remain dominant? Does China eclipse Silicon Valley, or are there many, many Silicon Valleys around the world? Hendrik,
That's the question that we had. So, and the results of the poll is only 3% of people will think that Silicon Valley will continue to dominate tech innovation as it does today. 13% think China will completely take over and innovation will come from China. And 84% think, well, innovation will happen, but in many valleys around the world, in Berlin, in Israel, in Mechelen, in Belgium, wherever in the world, innovation will happen and the dominance of Silicon Valley will go away a bit. What do you think about that, Kirsten?
So I have seen the emergence of innovation globally, and this has been happening, I would say, over the last 10 years. And tremendous innovation is coming out of pockets all over the world. And, look at Israel. It's been decades that Israel has been a center for innovation and in fact, has actually been a feeder for a lot of the Silicon Valley innovation. It actually has come out of Silicon Valley because we are quite acquisitive in that region. I think acquisition is going to play a part in answering that question. So what we have seen historically is we see innovation around the world and you see Silicon Valley companies going around the world and buying those companies, maintaining the dominance within Silicon Valley. Do I think that behavior is going to continue? Yes, absolutely. Will the momentum in some of the other parts of the world increase, either because of the changes we're seeing with the pandemic or some other market forces, such that there is a growing center or centers? I think that's a possibility, but I do think it's too early to call it and say that Silicon Valley is dead and we will not be a force in the future.
Okay, great. Now, I would like, Mark, if you don't mind, the key question of our conference today is what is it that we can learn from you folks? I mean, you've both been in large corporates and you have you are CIO, CTO in tech companies. How is it different to be a CIO in a high tech company? And what can CIOs and traditional corporates learn from your experiences? How would you, maybe Mark, let's start with you.
Well, when I think of the three things that are unique here, we've touched on this before. So setting aside the Googles and the Facebooks, the majority of companies are relatively small. The workforce is pretty young and they're growing rapidly. And when you put those kind of three ingredients together, the team is that kind of an organization is very receptive to change. There's not a lot of convention about the way things should be done or have been done in the past. Younger people are learning for the first time. Maybe they're on their second career opportunity, whatever. And in any process you put in place, the rate you grow, you outgrow your own process. Like, the way that you did, product launches or field conferences or whatever when you were had 500 customers is completely different when you have 4,000 customers. So my point is, I think in a larger company, and this isn't a new observation, you've got to try to recreate some of those conditions, those like small group opportunities where it's beneficial to your career, it's beneficial to the business. I mean, let's go all the way back to Skunk Works. I mean, what is a Skunk Works? It was taking some people and getting them out of the bureaucracy, putting them in a separate geographic place and say, go at it. You can do whatever you want, develop your own process, buy your own hardware. All we want is a e-commerce platform where we can start selling the same products that we've sold in retail stores through a mobile app. But we're not going to and actually, you see this actually in big companies. When IBM decides they want to make a smartphone, they can't get to market because of their own bureaucracy. I mean, it's such a huge company. And so many parts of the company want to participate in this grand crusade that it's almost by definition impossible to succeed. So anyway, get back to those three things. If you can inject some new skills, keep the team focused on some real clear objectives and just not to let them get submerged in the bigger morass of, you know, large company itis. And we suffer from that here. I'm not implying that we don't have that here. You know, the Cisco world or the Oracle world is very different today than what it was when the companies were originally founded. They were innovative companies at one time.
Now they're acquisitive companies.
So, Kirsten, how would you compare? I mean, you were CIO at Salesforce.com and Charles Schwab, two complete opposites, I would say. So what is it that a CIO and a bank can learn from a CIO at a high-tech company?
You know, I think one of the several key differences, I will also go with the rule of three. The differences that I saw in terms of how we brought products to market and really truly using agile methodologies to build very small intact teams that are focused on innovation and looking at the end-to-end new product introduction process. When I got to PayPal, it had started as a very small company, purchased by eBay, and then became a quite large company, probably about 17,000 people when I first joined back in 2017. They had completely lost their innovation engine, exactly from what Mark described. They just got so big. We had thousands of developers around the globe, and we couldn't get any new products to market. We couldn't get out of our own way. So shifted literally in a single day, took the entire, we had 403 Scrum teams that we created and started to work in an agile way. And the delta between new product introduction, we'd introduced like three new products in the 18 months prior to making that shift. And after we made that shift, we had 53 new products or features introduced within 6 months. So just the way that we were working and really truly, a lot of people say they work in agile. I often use the term fragile because it's not really agile, but truly sticking to the agile principles, I think unlocks a lot of the velocity of new product introduction. And that's what gets the innovation engine revving. If you've got a bunch of people who are, you know, dying to see something come to market and have worked their, you know, their hind ends off trying to get it out and they can't, that's how you start to have the talent drain, is you've got to be able to have people be able to physically see the things that they are creating come to market. That's how you keep people energized and really excited about your mission and what you're trying to achieve. The second thing is tied to people. So the creating opportunities for the high potential individuals within the organization. Mark touched on this as well. I cannot agree more that we often say, you know, to have that one developer that is absolutely fantastic, you're going to get 10x the output from that one person than you will get from everybody else. It is your, you know, mission and job within companies like mine to find those individuals and then constantly cultivate that capability and continue. You know, years and years ago, I went to a class at MIT about, you know, managing and leading technical professionals. And it was interesting. They did a big study and learned that when you give high potential individuals really huge opportunities, far outsize what it seems like their capability will be, they will rise to that challenge and ultimately be a far more capable leader, far more capable engineer, whatever they, you know, are destined to be. So as a leader, just always trying to outsize the problems that your top talent is trying to solve. Good news is we all have lots of big, you know, intractable problems that need to be solved. So it's a matter of finding those people with that potential and giving them those problems unbounded. I think that's another, you know, key thing that I have learned. And I think the third thing is around technical debt. The core, you know, one of the core technical differences in the bigger companies versus some of the newer startups and even companies like DocuSign. And I love DocuSign being named with Apple and Google and all these other companies. We're 4,000 employees. I know we seem huge like an Apple, but we are still, I would say, a very small company. But the tech debt that exists in the larger companies is suffocating. And it's for a lot of what you want to do, the tech debt keeps you, it's in the way of doing that. And it keeps people from working on the fun stuff as they're trying to just work through the tech debt. So key learning there is you break it down into bite-sized pieces and gradually then suddenly you move through it, but it's a multi-year, 3, 4, 5 year effort. You gotta stick to it. And that's what many companies, large and small, are lacking is the stick-to-itiveness gene of really sticking through these really hard and intractable, tech debt issues. So I think those are, you know, working in Agile, giving big opportunities to your high potential people and systematically working through your tech debt.
Okay, great, Kirsten. By the way, we just ran a small poll specifically on technical debt and if that's an important topic in your organization. 38% of the people said, yes, tech debt is a very important topic and we still have a high level of legacy apps and tech debt in the organization. 44% said we have a systematic approach to resolving that and to keep the debt to under control. And 19% said, well, what technical debt? We don't know. We don't have that problem. I would be interested to finding out who these people were. But, so that was the poll on technical debt. So thank you, Kirsten. Mark, back to you.
Yeah, I have a follow-up question for both of you. It's related to many of the topics we've talked about today, and that is, what is the role in boards of all of this? And, are they more technically savvy given the historical context a lot of these companies? And CIOs in the Valley have a different relationship with those boards and you can get more sponsorship and get more things done versus a traditional organization. So, the follow-on question is what can traditional companies learn about that relationship with a board in terms of getting things done? And Mark, we'll start with you on this one.
Well, I mean, the boards have different missions depending on the maturity of the company, right? And so if the board is a bunch of venture capitalists and they want to monetize their investment, so they're not particularly, they don't want to spend a lot of time worrying about whether we're going to get Workday or NetSuite to run our financials. And then I think things change on the other side as well. I don't think boards, and Kirsten, keep me honest here, but our boards are not going to worry a lot about like technical innovation because that's what the company's doing. I mean, that's what it's kind of all about. And the people running the company usually have the pedigree for doing that. So I think the boards really are trying to keep a lot of first generation CEOs out of trouble, out of business trouble, and make sure they understand, well, here's a good example. Once you become public and you're the CEO, 30 to 40% of your time is involved with broadcasting the message to the investment community and the pre-calls before the earnings call and the post-calls after the earnings call and, making sure each board member gets a little special attention or whatever. And that all takes time, so pretty soon people who thought, gee, it was fun to run this technical operation and grow this company, they find maybe to their chagrin that, oh my Lord, I spend like 40% of my time now doing these socialization things about how great the company is. And I guess that's fun. For some people, it is. That's what they always wanted to do. So Kirsten, keep me honest here. I haven't seen a lot of interaction with boards.
Yeah, okay. I definitely agree with Mark. I think that the boards of these companies, if they're focused on anything, it's, how do we optimize the go-to-market? How do we really look at the value proposition and how are we realizing that value proposition within the marketplace? There is not, boards are advisors and they are protectors of the shareholders. They are not running the company. And most boards recognize that's their role. And so business decisions around this technology or that technology. If it's a large financial investment, they may be interested, but they're interested more from the standpoint of, did we get the best deal? Do we have the right plan in place to be able to get this up and, you know, this new ERP system up and running in the shortest amount of time possible? Because we all know how disruptive replacing your ERP is, but it's not about permission of being able to do this or that. I do think that we benefit from having other leaders who've gone down this path before us. I mean, I talked at the top of the call about the fact that DocuSign has literally in the last year become a multi-product company. Back in 2008, when I first started at Salesforce, we were in the exact same place. We were at that time we called it SFA, Salesforce Automation. We were a CRM company and didn't have any other products. And so that transition from being a single product company to a multi-product company is huge for an organization. It's those kinds of strategic issues that the board weighs in with their experience on, which is really, really helpful as companies like ours are navigating that transition for the first time.
Hmm. Another Silicon Valley question. Both of you have been recipients of hundreds of tours, certainly dozens, if not hundreds, and you've been pulled in, and it'll be a bank from Norway, or it'll be an energy group from Spain. You've been on these dozens of them, right? We estimate prior to COVID, there's probably 200 delegations visiting a week in Silicon Valley. So we're getting a bit of a pause right now. What do those groups miss? They come here, they see 20, 25 companies in a week. They get this rapid fire sales pitches. They hear about the culture and then they go back and it's tough for them to implement what they saw here. What do you think the myths are? What do you think they miss when they really come here that they don't experience in a week that they may experience if they worked in one of these companies? Or do you think they miss anything?
I'll start. So I don't know if there's anything unique about, you know, what do you miss when you have this initial interaction with a vendor that's, you know, unique to the Valley. But two subjects that typically don't come up in these kind of speed dating environments is implementation issues, right? And so most vendors are going to go find the one customer that implemented the fastest for whatever set of reasons. And they're going to say, well, this is the way it always works. It's plug and play. If you buy this like 3 weeks later, you just wake up and suddenly it's magically working. But I think, you know, most seasoned CIOs, they're kind of suspicious of that. But the other, maybe the more important one to come to talk about and to realize, you know, again, many vendors do this. So pick up on Kirsten's point before, this range of products that I'm offering you as a vendor. Well, behind the scenes, typically, you know, those products have very significant difference of uptake and utilization of the marketplace. And when it's presented to you as a smorgasbord, you know, of all these things, you sort of think, well, this is great. And of course, the vendor's saying it all works together to do fabulous things. And, you know, I'll pick on AWS. If you look at AWS's revenues, it's 70% compute, it's 20% storage, and this whole, you know, constellation of other services that they offer just are not all that, you know, revenue significant at the end of the day. And so, of course, now why is that important? For two reasons. One, there's not as large a community with experience, user community, that has experience using some of these ancillary kinds of products that haven't been used on a widespread basis. And it's also a watch out call, because if the vendor is not going to get traction with those kind of capabilities, guess what? They're going to go out of business. They're not going to, I mean, that they will stop that product. They'll merge it into something else. They'll sell it off or whatever. And so if you're mesmerized by, you know, five different things and you find out, you know, 2/3 of the install base is using number one and, you know, half of it's using number two, and the other three things that really excite me, less than 2% of the install base is touching that thing. If that's why you're buying it, I mean, three out of the five are things that are very widely used in practice, then that's a wake-up call. And you're not going to see that in the classic kind of marketing presentations, you know, the pitches that you normally get.
So the implementation piece and then the features functions piece as it maps to what their needs are.
Really look at like utilization within install base. Yep.
Got it. And Kirsten, to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, it's another way of saying what Mark has said in Mark Zawacki, you and I were in a consulting firm together. Ooh, I gave it away. Yeah. And one of the things we looked at was, you know, it's not the underlying technology, it's that end-to-end process that really makes a difference of whether or not something is going to be efficient and effective. And so many companies, when they come, I loved Mark's comment, the speed dating, when they come and do speed dating in the Valley, they hear all about the technology. And if they don't do the hard work of re-engineering that end-to-end process of where they're having their critical pain points, really no technology that they bring in to sort of underlie a broken process is going to make things better. And so I think that, and you're not going to talk about that because nobody wants to talk about business process. It's like, ugh, you know, it's not the sexy stuff. It's been hard for as long as I've been in this business. I don't imagine it getting easier because it is complicated. It's messy. It's harder to control because you're not within one function. I mean, if we all could just get things done within our function, we know just how much more efficient that would be, because where things become less efficient and when it becomes harder is when you're having to deal with 3, 5, 10, 15 different parts of a company in order to get something done. And that's the stuff we don't talk about in these sessions. We talk about the sexy technology. And that's, I think, part of why as companies go back and implement the sexy technology, they don't see the results that that they are hoping for.
I got one last theme or question I want to close on. A lot of listeners today are responsible for innovation in their organizations. And the paradox seems to be that it's a wonderful time to innovate right now. The boundaries between industries are shifting. There's a whole lot of moving parts. People are, you know, right before our very eyes in the last month, seeing so many industries fundamentally need to change. But the paradox is their share price may be depressed, their budgets are getting cut. They know that furloughs and layoffs could be coming later this year. So at the very time they may need to double down on innovation, it requires some spin. They may not have the requisite resources to do so. So do you agree with the thesis? Can you offer any guidance, any perspectives around that? And Mark, I'll start with you and then Kirsten can add.
You always start with me and then she gets to think, you know, come up with a better answer. So.
You just get to make me look smarter, Mark, and I'm so grateful.
I'm feeling defensive here. You know, well, obviously, if you're in dire financial straits, I mean, you have other problems to go solve, and you know, survival is more important than innovation. And so I don't want to be too glib about this, because obviously some companies in certain industries are in serious trouble. You know, I think one well you can go back and tap is the stuff you already bought. So again, Kirsten knows very well. You go look at the collection of stuff you've invested in, and it has all this functional capability, and we're only using like 20% of this thing that we have. And it's largely because of the change management issues that Kirsten talked about before, you know, the end-to-end. Oh yeah, this would help in order management, except, you know, we never thought about that before. This could be extended. So I think that's a possibility. And the other thing I would recommend is, this is, I think, something that's beneficial in almost any kind of situation. You know, you've seen a huge focus on automation technologies of all descriptions. The RPA, the robotic process automation, vendors are out there hawking their wares. You've got workflow automation that ServiceNow and other kinds of tools that are out there. There's a lot of task and project management automation with tools like Trello and Asana and Workfront and Smartsheet and Monday that are out there. And I think, you know, this would appeal to a cost-cutting culture, but also to, I think, maybe like a digital transformation movement if you're trying to drive more progressive innovation. which is just look at the array of tools that you have and put together a center of excellence that can figure out like, what's the right tool for this problem? Let's not just go off and use Workfront for everything, or let's not build bots to do everything. I mean, there's no one technology that's applicable across the board. And I think that, you know, will pay dividends downstream. It's sort of what I think, Mark, you brought up the point before. If you really make that concentrated effort around some kind of an automation center of excellence, you know, 2 or 3 years downstream, you might look back at the crisis and say, that's like one of the best things that we ever did. I mean, it's staff productivity, business velocity, reduction in error rates, better customer experience because we're able to respond faster. All those kinds of benefits are out there. They just have to be harvested in some kind of a focused way.
Fantastic. And Kirsten, your thoughts on this paradox?
Yeah, I mean, I think all companies have more opportunities, more work to do than they have resources at any given moment. Even, you know, when things are flush, you always have more to do than you have money or resources. So in this time, as in every time, it really comes down to maniacal prioritization. And if you truly are in this survival mode, as Mark said, you have to be really focused on that survival. So then the prioritization comes to looking at what are those, you know, end-to-end processes that are going to drive the most revenue, and which are the end-to-end processes that are going to harvest the most cost reduction. And there should only be two things on that list. And all resources within the organization should focus on one of those two things. How do you get more money in the door, and how do you get more costs out of the system? And that in that way, you galvanize the company around survival. And every single person knows they're working on the thing that is going to make or break the company at that point. And it either is going to work, or, you know, we see in a lot of cases it's not going to work. But I think that's absolutely essential in making sure that, you know, you don't try to fix it in 17 different places. That's my number one. And the second is the app rationalization. Is absolutely critical. You know, at companies like ours, and I'm sure it's true of many, many people who are on this webinar, we use no software left behind. We have every software that's ever been sold, it seems, in the organization, and rationalizing that down to the one, and in very few cases, the two things that do the majority of what you need is it simplifies everything. And simple is good, particularly in times like these.
Okay.
Great.
Great. Thank you. We're coming to the end of this web conference. So I would maybe ask Mark, could you, in a nutshell, tell us what your book is all about? I mean, it has this wonderful title, Truth from the Valley. So why should people go out and buy your book, and what can they learn from that?
Here it is, Mark. I have a copy today.
Hey, best part of the whole call. I published this earlier this year, and it talks about the people and operational practices and technology management methodologies that you see in these kind of high growth, high-tech companies here in the Valley. And, you know, there's a Canadian science fiction writer whose name escapes me at the moment, but there's a quote that, you know, the future's already here, it's just unevenly distributed. And we have the hubris in the Valley to think that, you know, we're at ground zero, and that many of the issues that we talked about today about talent recruiting and retention and, you know, internal processes that we use and some of the new technologies that are coming along are going to be on the doorstep of everybody who's here on the call. And frankly, a lot of it priority is on your doorstep. And I think what you have to do is look at this whole landscape, whether it's your skills, whether it's your internal operations, whether it's the technologies that are available to you, and come up with some kind of a strategic plan and place your bets as a CIO. You can't be good at everything. You can't like have, you know, the best security practices and the best software development and app support practices and the best, the list goes on. And so within your business model and with the opportunities that your company faces, you know, you should provide some IT leadership to say, let's put in place the IT infrastructure that we need to really drive the growth of this company. And I think the book could be used as a strategic planning document in that regard, kind of look at the end-to-end opportunities, you know, and then decide what you want to double down on.
Okay, great. Thank you
for the opportunity, Hendrik. Very gracious. I appreciate it.
I highly recommend both of Mark's books. I have had the honor and privilege of knowing Mark for many, many years, and his wisdom, he is so gracious in giving in his knowledge and his learning, and I have seen him over the years, and he has been fabulous to me and helping me in my career as well. So please read Mark's book.
Okay. Thank you for these wise words, Kirsten, and thank you for your time. Thank you for your time, Mark, as well. Mark Zawacki, some final words from you, sir.
No, I appreciate everyone participating today. Thank you for welcoming the US team, and we're delighted to talk to prospects about what we're doing with CIONET in the US.
Okay, great. And with that, we're gonna show you a couple of last slides for today. So thank you, everybody that participated and the panel of our conference. We're doing this for the last 6 months now, these international web conferences. We started back in February, and now we discussed all different types of topics. And we've got a new one coming up on the 19th of August, where we're going to discuss female digital leadership and what is it special that women can bring to digital leadership, and how can we get more of women, which is of course would be a wonderful thing. So make sure that you put that in your agenda and block the 19th of August. So the last couple of actions for everybody who is following this conference, make sure if you're a digital leader to join CIONET, just go to CIONET.com and start talking to our chatbot, and we'll qualify if you can become a member. It's very, very easy. Make sure to follow us on CIONET.tv. That will bring you to our YouTube channel. A lot of good content, a lot of very interesting deep dive interviews and web conferences that are available on that. And of course, follow us on LinkedIn as well. And with that, we are at the end of this conference. Thank you, everybody. And we're going to go out with a small video on CIONET TV, and see you all very soon again. Bye for now.
For the last 15 years, I've been on a quest to discover the DNA of the most successful digital leaders in the world. What makes them tick, what's in their minds and in their hearts. We are sharing deep insights from our world-class CIOs so that you get inspired, can learn and reach your full potential as a digital leader. If you are an ambitious technology executive, then I invite you to join CIONET. Join our community so that you too can realize your ambition.